All right. Well, welcome everyone. Hello and good morning.
Morning.
And happy birthday to Pastor Julie, if you didn't hear that already. We have a couple announcements this morning. First of all, it is Communion Sunday. And so now is a good time to gather your communion elements, your bread or crackers, your wine or grape juice. And it's also okay if you only have one element to have communion in one kind, meaning either just the bread or just the wine or grape juice. It's also okay to not commune if you want to instead pray the prayer of spiritual communion, which will be on the screen during that time. Also, now you can enter your prayer requests. Type them into the chat feature and we will read those prayers during the prayers of intercession. That appears as a little speech bubble at the bottom center of your screen. There will be two online learning opportunities beginning this week. On Wednesday nights, you can join An Introduction to Islam, led by the Imam of the mosque here in Avon. And on Thursday nights, you can join a small group gathering focusing on prayer and sharing our faith stories. Contact the office for more information about that. Council nominations are due this week, so please put some thought and prayer into who you might feel would be a good leader of this congregation and who might feel called to be on council. And lastly, happy Epiphany Sunday to everyone. It is the 10th day of Christmas and the Sunday in which we celebrate Epiphany. So blessings to you all this morning. We're so glad you're here. And now we invite you to prepare yourselves for worship. Oh, and mute yourselves, too, if you haven't already. Thank you.
Now it says...
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Of your Son by the brilliant shining of a star. Shine the light of your justice always in our hearts and over all lands, and accept our lives as the treasure we offer in your praise and for your service. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen. And it's now time for the children's sermon. Today we are celebrating the Epiphany, which actually happens on January 6th, but being that this is the first Sunday closest to January 6th, we're celebrating today. Epiphany is the day, the 12th day of Christmas, when we celebrate the arrival of the Magi, or they're also known as the kings or the wise men, to visit Jesus And the Gospel of Matthew talks about how these magi, or these learned people, followed a star to come to the place where Jesus had been born. Matthew writes, "On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary and his mother and were filled with joy." Because the Magi visited Jesus in his house, Epiphany has often been traditionally a time for house blessings. In fact, in Eastern Europe, Christians would make an inscription over the door to the house. And in fact, we're going to take a peek right now of how that is done. Here I am in front of my house. You place numbers of the year above the door with three letters in between. So you'll see that I'm writing the number 20, and then there are three letters, C, M, and B. You'll get a closer up look in a moment. The letters mean Christe Mansionem Benedicat, which is a Latin blessing meaning Christ bless this house. The first two numbers are 20 for the 2000 part, and the last two numbers are 21 for 2021. Those three letters in the middle can also stand for the traditional names given to the wise men or magi, Caspar, Melchior, and Balthazar. Now, most of us are pretty happy to say goodbye to 2020 and to welcome in 2021. But truthfully, we don't know what 2021 will bring. It may have many hard months, just like 2020. For this reason, it seems to me especially appropriate that we bless our homes in this year, because it is a reminder to us that God blesses us in all circumstances, in good times and in bad, in favorable times and in unfavorable times. And so today I wish you and all in your house the Epiphany blessing, Christe Mansionem Benedicat. May Christ bless you and all who enter your house in any and all circumstances this coming year. Amen.
Amen.
We continue now with the reading from Scripture.
A reading from Isaiah. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For darkness shall cover the earth, and thick darkness the peoples. But the Lord will arise upon you, and his glory will appear over you. Nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. Lift up your eyes and look around. They all gather together. They come to you. Your sons shall come from far away, and your daughters shall be carried on their nurses' arms. Lift up your eyes and look around. They all gather together. They come to you. Your sons shall come from far away, and your daughters shall be carried on their nurses' arms. Then you shall see and be radiant. Your heart shall thrill and rejoice, because the abundance of the sea shall be brought to you. The wealth of the nations shall come to you. A multitude of camels shall cover you, the young camels of Midian and Ephah, all those from Sheba shall come. They shall bring gold and frankincense and shall proclaim the praise of the Lord, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh,
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the second chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born king of the Jews? For we have observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all of Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent to them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out. And there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary and his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. About 5 years ago, my family and I vacationed at the Grand Canyon. We happened to overlap with a convention of astronomers. Professionals and amateurs invited the public to come and look through their telescopes, which were pointed to the night sky. Now, true confessions, I've never been much for astronomy. It entailed way too much neck craning in the middle of the night in the cold. Plus, it seemed like I never saw anything worthwhile, perhaps a slightly larger star through that telescope, but never a meteor or anything that I could truly recognize. I found that it was just frankly more enjoyable to stay in my cozy bed. I nonetheless joined my family and the crowd who came to peer through these telescopes to the heavens beyond. Led by infrared flashlights so we would not cause light pollution, my family made our way to a woman with a telescope. "Would you like to see Mars?" she inquired. We stepped up to the telescope, and there in plain sight was Mars with its reddish glow. "That's cool," I thought. At other telescopes, we looked at some stars and learned how many light years away they were and what their names were. But when I stepped up to a telescope pointed towards Saturn, I gasped. There it was, the gas giant, its rings clearly visible, just like I'd seen in books. I immediately felt connected in a way I never had before. "It's real," I thought, as if this were some unique revelation. And to me, it was. For in that moment, I connected with Saturn and Mars and the stars, no longer a far-off concept, some theoretical notion of heavenly bodies. They became, for me, true planets, true worlds, connected to my world and my experience. The Magi in our gospel lesson today were people who connected to the stars. They were astrologers from the East, Persia probably, now modern day Iran. They trace the movements of the celestial bodies for spiritual and scientific wisdom. And Matthew says that they were guided by a star to the baby Jesus. There, they met within a tiny child, the God of the universe. Talk about being connected. That is exactly what incarnation is about, being connected. Incarnation means that the divine becomes human. Jesus is the place where God takes on flesh, the place where the infinite becomes touchable. God was not satisfied in being a far-off concept, a theoretical notion of divine benevolence. God wanted to connect to human experience and the human world. Connection is something we are all particularly longing for right now. We all know that the pandemic has separated us into household pods and removed us from our communities. While we are grateful for technologies like Zoom and the good old telephone, we long for human touch and the sense of oneness that we can only get from being in person together. In times of crisis, people need to connect to something greater than themselves. And it's really no surprise, therefore, that during the first wave of the pandemic, Google searches for the word prayer hit an all-time high. We as human beings have the need to connect to one another and also to God. As it turns out, this longing for connection is a perennial one, shared by people across the ages. Human beings need community, a sense of purpose, a place in the world around them. One way of making this connection has been religion. In fact, the word religion comes from the same Latin root as the word for ligament. The root is ligare, which means to connect. Religion, re ligare, means to connect again. Religions at their root are designed to connect us once again to our core. They are meant to connect us to God, our neighbors, and the world around us. I think this original definition of religion is especially important to note at a time when many of our family and friends call themselves spiritual but not religious. Religion these days has been identified with rote practices and dogma instead of something that's alive within people. And so I think it is really important to reclaim the word religion for its original meaning, and to begin to articulate for ourselves what practices and insights make connections for us. How does your practice of Christianity connect you to others, to yourself, to God? Is there a specific faith practice that connects you to the world around you and to the divine? Are there scriptures or hymns or particular places that make you feel connected? Particular activities that brings you into the holy presence? I was connected through the silent majesty of Saturn. What is it for you? The point of our Christian religion, revealed in the incarnation of Jesus, is that we are connected again by that baby born 2,000 years ago. In Jesus, the original connection that had been severed by sin and separation has been brought back and healed. And as reconnected people, we join Christ in that spiritual work to unite that which has been wrenched apart and to heal our separated worlds. Which brings me back to the Grand Canyon. The passion of those astronomers for their art showed me a world that I had never connected with. They made a connection between their world and mine. God did the same thing for us in Jesus. In becoming human, God connected in the most intimate way in our lives. God allowed us to touch and to hold God himself. This imminent God among us continues to show up today in our community of St. Matthew, in our prayer life, in our relationships, in our work, and in our partners and ministry who make a difference nearby and far away. We are called to be like the astronomers at the Grand Canyon, passionate enough to share the connections we have made with others, committed enough to take the time to show beginners the marvels of faith, courageous enough to make a connection between our world and someone else's. Because when it gets right down to it, that's what God did for us in Jesus. In Jesus, God connected us again to ourselves, to each other, to the world, and to God. Amen.
Activity out there.
We now continue with the Nicene Creed.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made. Of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit, and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and we look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please join us for the prayers of intercession. Each petition will end with the words, "Hear us, O God," to which the congregation may respond, "Your mercy is great." Joining our voices with the song of the angels, let us pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Glorious God, you are not satisfied being a far-off concept, but drew near to us in human life of Jesus. As you connect to us in Christ, reconnect us to one another and the whole human family. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Reconnect us to this fragile and beautiful planet, our earthly home. Place wonders into our hearts as we search the skies. Notice the small miracles of winter and care for the environment. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Reconnect nations and governmental leaders and the goal of serving the common good. Curb selfish motivations and rise up advocates who champion the cause of exploited and vulnerable people. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Reconnect all who seek love, support, and restoration. Dispel fears and shadows. Restore broken relationships and mend broken hearts. Bring relief to those who are sick or struggling, especially those who are in the front lines of the pandemic, those who have suffered the loss of loved ones. Be near those we name, especially our nation, that as one people, we may seek and promote the common good. Debbie Steinberg's son, Louie, and his family as he is COVID positive. Please pray for Fred Krompegel as he continues to struggle and for Teresa Rogensky as she mourns the loss of her mother, for Carolyn and family and Heather. In Thanksgiving for Dick Runing's and Bill White's successful surgeries and prayers for their continued recovery. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Reconnect us to those who have gone before us, O God, according to the boundless riches of Christ. Sustain all who grieve and remind us of your promise to make all things new in the splendor of your glory. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God of mercy, come quickly to us and grace upon us, upon grace, as we lift these and all our prayers to you. In the name of Jesus, amen.
At this time, we invite you to gather your communion elements, your bread or crackers, and wine or grape juice. I will invite you to consume the elements following the words of institution and the Lord's Prayer. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ. By the leading of a star, he was shown forth to all nations. In the waters of the Jordan, you proclaimed him your beloved Son. And in the miracle of water turned to wine, he revealed your glory. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as our Lord taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you.
Lord Jesus, in this simple meal, you have set a banquet. Sustain us on the journey, strengthen us to care for the least of your beloved children, and give us glad and generous hearts as we meet you on the way. Amen. Amen.
May God, the Creator, strengthen you. Jesus, the Beloved, fill you. And the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, keep you in peace. Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace. Be the light of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you everyone for joining us today for our Epiphany celebration on the second Sunday of Christmas. We wish you peace in your home and peace in the world and God's blessing in any and all circumstances. I invite you to share a sign of peace with those around you. Maybe you'd like to share the wave icon, send a message in the chat to individuals or the group, or simply to say, yo, peace. Welcome you also to stick around for our virtual coffee hour. And I do have a question of the day. It's the one I posed in the sermon. It is there a spiritual practice or a part of your Christian faith that connects you to God particularly, or to the world around you, to others, or to yourself? So I invite you to share what that point of connection is for you today or in general. Thank you all for joining us. God bless.